I just feel the need to say that if there's anybody who somewhere inside them feels themselves here to be an outsider, not quite belonging, not quite part of things, not quite acceptable, then there's a message here for you. God has no favourites. God has no favourites.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspiring biblical teaching and other excellent Christian videos. You can order the teaching video DVDs, listen to and study the audio versions of these, or download them as audio podcasts to your computer or MP3 player. Today's inspiring and biblical teaching is called Watch Out, Angels About, Acts chapter 10, by Joan Maple.
I was at Parent and Toddlers 3 weeks ago, sitting with one of the grandmothers who come with their grandchildren. And this grandmother leaned across at me and said, "You ready for Christmas?" "What?" "Ready for Christmas?" I said, "It's only November. I don't start until December." And she looked shocked and she said, "I've done all my Christmas buying." Well, there you go. Have to be different kinds of people. There have to be the last minute shoppers as well as the July shopping for Christmas people, don't there? But it did prompt me, first of all, to buy some cards, and secondly, to read Luke's account of the first one of his Gospels. And I was struck by the number of times that angels appear. Angels were and are messengers. And they don't just bring a little cheer up message, cheer up, the Lord loves you kind of message. They usually bring something startling. Think, for example, of the angel appearing to Mary, and you couldn't have a much more startling message than that, could you? That she was going to have a child, she wasn't married, and he was going to be the son of the Most High God. Wow. So, I wonder how you'd feel if an angel appeared to you. Take just a minute to say to the person next to you whether you would welcome or not a visit from an angel messenger. What do you think? Just have a quick word with the person near you. Yes, people don't look too startled at the moment at the thought, but you could be pretty sure that if an angel came and spoke to you, something new would be going to happen. Not just, there, God loves you, although it's true, but something new would be happening. In Luke's second book, The Acts of the Apostles, though some people think it should be called The Acts of the Holy Spirit, he records angels appearing to people there. And we're going to look at one important occasion where this happens in the book of Acts. So would you find chapter 10 of Acts? In the ordinary sized Bible, it's page 1103. And in the large one, it's 1945. And we're going to look at this whole chapter because it's such an exciting story. Such a very exciting story. Before we start, and if you found it, will you look back across at verse 31 of the chapter before, which says, then the church, and then it says where, enjoyed a time of peace. It was strengthened and encouraged by the Holy Spirit. It grew in numbers, living in the fear of the Lord. That's a lovely verse, isn't it? That's lovely. And it felt to me as though, to a degree, it describes us in this present time of church, that we are enjoying peace, that we are being strengthened, that we're being encouraged by the Holy Spirit, and we're growing in numbers, living in the fear of the Lord. And that's not quaking fear, but it's awe at what God's doing. So what's happened before this time of peace? Well, lots of things. Do you remember how Stephen was stoned because of the sermon he gave that the authorities didn't like? He was stoned to death. And you remember once Paul was converted that the Jews tried to kill him. At one time he had to be let down over the wall in a basket at night to escape from the people who were watching the gates. So it was quite an exciting, turbulent, dangerous time. And then comes a time of peace. Peter, meanwhile, is plodding round the country, visiting churches. Not buildings, of course. Churches meeting in people's houses and people's homes, preaching and healing. He's the old Peter that we knew, but he's also a new Peter with new gifting and new powers by the Holy Spirit. And he's now arrived in Joppa, which is on the seaside. And it's the old version of Jaffa today. So let's look at the beginning of chapter 10. We're not starting in Joppa, you notice. At Caesarea, there was a man named Cornelius, a centurion in what was known as the Italian regiment. He and all his family were devout and God-fearing. He gave generously to those in need and prayed to God regularly. That's a good testimony, isn't it? One day at about 3 p.m, he had a vision. He distinctly, notice that word distinctly, saw an angel of God who came to him and said, Cornelius. Cornelius stared at him in fear. What is it, Lord? He asked. The angel answered, your prayers and gifts to the poor have come up as a memorial offering before God. Now send men to Joppa to bring back a man named Simon, who is called Peter. He is staying with Simon the tanner, whose house is by the sea. Even gives him the address. When the angel who spoke to him had gone, Cornelius called two of his servants and a devout soldier who was one of his attendants. He told them everything that had happened and sent them to Joppa. Don't you warm to this man? Don't you warm to him as a person? Don't you warm to him in his response to the angel? He didn't run away. He didn't say, who do you think you are telling me, a centurion in charge of 100 soldiers, what to do? He was an outsider, don't forget. He was a non-Jew, belonged to the Italians. And in spite of being devout and God-fearing, he was a lesser person in the eyes of the Jews and in the eyes of their faith. He was a kind of untouchable, though that word wasn't used there. But he was considered an outsider, a lesser person, by most Jews, even the Christian ones. But here he is, full of enthusiasm for God, probably drawn towards the Jewish faith by their strong moral stand, by the strong rules of conduct, behavior, and life that we've been looking at in Exodus. But meanwhile, back in Joppa, we find Peter is staying with Simon the tanner. Now that's interesting, because a tanner was considered rather an outsider too, because of all his contact with dead animals. And a lot of people would have looked askance at Simon the tanner, but Peter goes and stays with him. Interesting, isn't it? Peter's rigid attitudes already being loosened by the work of Jesus in his life. So we're back in Joppa, verse 9. About noon the following day, as they were on their journey, you see we've got the sea over here and Joppa, and then Caesarea is up here, up above Galilee. Okay, so it's quite a journey to go. Peter went up on the roof to pray. He became hungry and wanted something to eat. And while the meal was being prepared, he fell into a trance. I'm encouraged by this. It sounds silly, but, well, there you go. The very first time I tried to do a 24-hour fast, the only thing I could think of when I prayed was food. I was so disappointed. I thought I was going to have great breakthroughs in my prayer life. And all I could think about was what I would have to eat when the fasting was over. Ah, that's a confession, isn't it? And Peter went up to pray, but clearly he was thinking about food as well. So I wasn't the only one. Perhaps we both matured a bit since then. He saw heaven opened and something like a large sheet being let down to earth by its four corners. It contained all kinds of four-footed animals, as well as reptiles of the earth and birds of the air. Then a voice told him, "Get up, Peter, kill and eat." "Surely not, Lord," Peter answered. "I've never eaten anything impure or unclean. The message puts it, I've never eaten anything that wasn't kosher." The voice spoke to him again. "Do not call anything impure that God has made clean." This happened three times, and immediately the sheet was taken back to heaven. Do you see an echo of the old Peter here? The old Peter, "Surely not, Lord. Lord, you're not going to wash my feet. Lord, no, you're not going to do this. I don't want that." Ha! While Peter was wondering about the meaning of this vision, the men sent by Cornelius found out where Simon's house was and stopped at the gate. They called out, asking if Simon, who was known as Peter, was staying there. While Peter was still thinking about the vision, the Spirit said to him, "Simon, three men are looking for you. So get up and go downstairs. Do not hesitate to go with them, for I've sent them." Peter went down and said to the men, "I'm the one you're looking for. Why have you come?" Notice that Peter didn't get an angel. He he heard the Spirit speaking to him inside. And I think it's more likely that this is how we hear the Spirit speak to us. We considered at the beginning how we'd feel if suddenly there was an angel in front of us. But it's more likely that we hear the Spirit speaking to us. Because we've got, if we belong to Jesus, we've got the Spirit dwelling in us. And he is able to speak into our life and guide our life as we go along. So Peter is prepared. The Holy Spirit's at work. Combination of angel at Caesarea, the Spirit giving Peter a vision and speaking to him in explanation, some explanation, but not very much. And there, this new move has started. Neither Cornelius nor Peter know what it's all about yet, but God knows what it's all about. Peter went down and said to the men, "I'm the one you're looking for. Why have you come?" A couple of outsiders and a soldier. The men replied, "We've come from Cornelius, the centurion." Aha, underlined that he's an outsider. "But he is a righteous and God-fearing man who is respected by all the Jewish people. A holy angel told him to have you come to his house so that he could hear what you have to say." Then Peter invited the men into the house to be his guests. I like that. Peter inviting them in to be his guests. It's not his house. I hope Simon the Tanner was quite happy with that, suddenly having three visitors for supper that he hadn't catered for. But there you go. So there we are. Notice that Cornelius didn't come himself. I wonder why. We'll soon find out. The next day, Peter started out with them, and some of the brothers from Joppa went along. The following day, he arrived in Caesarea. Cornelius was expecting them and had called together his relatives and close friends. See, Cornelius has been busy. This is not just for him, he senses. This is for others as well. As Peter entered the house, Cornelius met him and fell at his feet in reverence. But Peter made him get up. "Stand up," he said. "I'm a man like yourself." Talking with him, Peter went inside and found a large gathering of people. He said to them, "You are well aware that it's against our law for a Jew to associate with a Gentile or visit him. But God has shown me that I should not call any man pure or unclean. So when I was sent for, I came without raising any objections. May I ask," of course he may, "why you sent for me?" So this vision has been working its way round in his mind, and he has made a connection in his mind between the non-kosher animals and this group of people who are waiting for him. And he can see what God is trying to say to him. Cornelius says, 4 days ago, I was in my house praying at this hour, at 3 p.m, and suddenly a man in shining clothes stood before me and said, Cornelius, God has heard your prayers and remember your gifts to the poor. Send to Joppa for Simon, who is called Peter. He is a guest in the home of Simon the Tanner, who lives by the sea. So I sent for you immediately, and it was good of you to come. Now we are all here in the presence of God to listen to everything the Lord has commanded you to tell us. Here's some faith. He says very politely to Peter, it's good of you to come. And yet he's taken it for granted that he will, because he's gathered everybody together. He's gathered his friends. He's gathered his family, all waiting. He's never met this Peter. He doesn't know how Peter will react to the invitation. It was good of you to come, he says. I wonder if we have this sense of expectancy when we meet together. On an ordinary Sunday morning, whether we are expectant of what God's going to say and what God's going to do. Even if there isn't a Peter to preach to us, I wonder if we do come with that sense of expectancy. Some of us pray at 9:30 on Sunday mornings, and we do pray for everybody coming to church that God will touch them, that God will bless them, that God will speak to them. We need to be expectant, as Cornelius and his friends and his family were expectant. Now it's time you heard a different voice, because Peter began to speak, and this is what he said.
I now realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism, but accepts men from every nation who fear him and do what is right. You know the message God sent to the people of Israel, telling the good news of peace through Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all. You know what has happened throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee, after the baptism that John preached, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and how he went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil, because God was with him. We are witnesses of everything he did in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They killed him by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him from the dead on the third day and caused him to be seen. He was not seen by all the people, but by witnesses who God had already chosen, by us who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one whom God appointed as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name.
What a message. The good news in a nutshell. The good news. Peter too was being an angel, because an angel is a messenger. And those of you here who are evangelists, you've got the word angel in the middle of your title. So what happened? They didn't just say, interesting. Yeah, that was interesting, wasn't it? Oh, I don't know, I was asleep. Oh, were you? Oh, well, it was good, it was good. He said, what did you think of it? You know, it wasn't like that. The effect was amazing. the effect was absolutely amazing. While Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit came on all who heard the message. The circumcised believers who had come with Peter were astonished that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on the Gentiles. For they heard them speaking in tongues and praising God. Wow, what a response. What a response. Now, we'll consider this. This was a wide open audience, ready to hear what God was going to say to them. The expectation had built up, and wow, it happened. It happened. In his introduction to Acts, Eugene Peterson, the writer of the Message, talking about Luke's gospel and now Acts of the Apostles, says, when we read it, we could easily become enthusiastic spectators and then let it go at that, become admirers of Jesus, generous with our alls and ours, and in our better moments, inspired to imitate him. But that's not how these people received the word. Peter told them what had happened from his own experience, and the Holy Spirit himself reinforced the word. Paul tells us in another place that over 500 people saw and heard Jesus after his resurrection. Cornelius must have been thinking, ah, this was worth them trekking to Joppa for. This was worth Peter's journey. This was worth the waiting by the friends and relations, not sure when he would get there. The Holy Spirit came on all who heard the message, and a strategic move on God's part began, starting with an angel and ending with the Spirit's work, reinforcing Peter's message. Verse 45. The circumcised believers who had come with Peter were astonished that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on the Gentiles, for they heard them speaking in tongues and praising God. Then Peter said, "Can anyone keep these people from being baptized with water? They have received the Holy Spirit just as we have." So he ordered that they be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they asked Peter to stay with them for a few days. Can you imagine the time they had in those 3 days? Or 4 days, however many it turned out to be. But it was all the wrong way round. It was all wrong. They should have been baptized with water and then filled with the Holy Spirit. When we baptize people here, we baptize them in water and then we all pray for them that they'll be filled with the Spirit. It was wrong. Well, it wasn't wrong, was it? The Holy Spirit has his own agenda. And he doesn't do things the way we expect him to. And on this occasion, wouldn't you say that Peter needed the evidence, didn't he? Peter needed the evidence that the Holy Spirit was there for them too. As I say, it must have been a wonderful few days. I wonder if they came down to earth at all in those 3 days or however many. newly introduced to Jesus, newly filled with the Spirit. Wow, what a time it must have been. We can look at a story like this and say, this was then, and we are now. Things happened then that don't happen now. Well, I for one don't believe it. I for one think that what happens there, it's the same Spirit, the same God, the same Lord Jesus, and even sometimes the same angels are at work in our world today, in our church today. I came up with a theory. I decided that angels appeared to those who haven't yet got the Holy Spirit living in them. They need somebody to come from outside and speak to them. And the Holy Spirit speaks directly into the mind and heart of those living in the Spirit. But that theory doesn't hold water either. You can't pin God down like that. An angel appeared to Philip when he was evangelizing and told him to go to a certain place. An angel appeared to Paul when he was in prison. No, Peter, and helped him out. Yes, it was Peter was in prison and an angel came and unlocked the door. We can't pin God down. Sometimes we wish we could, because it would make things much neater in our little world if we could pin God down. If we glance back at that verse we started with in chapter 9, where the church at Greenford was enjoying a time of peace. It's being strengthened and encouraged by the Holy Spirit, growing in numbers and living in the fear or awe of the Lord. It sounds comfortable. Does sound comfortable. Yes, we've had new things this year. Some of us older ones have creaked a little bit with some of the changes that have happened. But still, we're all coping. But I don't believe we're going to stay comfortable. I really don't believe we are. In Acts here, that time of blessing meant that new things were just around the corner. The Holy Spirit leading in surprising new directions. Outsiders coming in. What is God by His Spirit going to do here next? More new things? Are we ready for them? Think of all the outreach that's going to happen between now and the end of the year, counting the New Year party come service. How many people's lives are going to be touched? Are we listening to the Spirit as Peter was? Each of us, don't you dare just leave it to the leadership team or those who've been prayed for as evangelists. It's all of us. He's the same Spirit at work. And we're going to see wonders. Some of them might set us back on our heels a bit and think, oh, is this what we wanted? Maybe it isn't what we wanted, but if it's what God wants, well, hard luck, church. You just get on with it. And when I say you, I mean me as well. We're living in exciting times. We're living in very exciting times. In case anybody is not comfortable with the thought of the Holy Spirit being in charge, let me just say that there's nothing spooky about this. This is the Spirit of Jesus, our Lord, at work in his church. Vital to our lives and work. I've said to some of you before that I come from a time in church where the Holy Spirit was hardly ever mentioned. Oh yeah, maybe once a year when it was Pentecost. And it was not exciting. But we're here now. And the Spirit's at work in our church. We know that. And we need to be listening and preparing, as Cornelius and his friends were, for the next thing. A church would have started where Cornelius lived, yeah? He and his friends would have started a new church, a church of Gentiles, and they'd have attracted other Gentiles, other outsiders, and they would have been part of the new thing that God was doing. Hallelujah. I wonder, something kind of nudged me when I was looking at this chapter about this word outsider. And I just feel the need to say that if there's anybody who somewhere inside them feels themselves here to be an outsider, not quite belonging, not quite part of things, not quite acceptable, then there's a message here for you. God has no favorites. God has no favorites. Peter said, I realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism, but accepts men and women from every nation and condition who fear him and do what is right, or who are prepared to fear him and do what's right. And that is the gospel. That is the gospel. Accept that for yourself. So here we are. Peter was living by the Spirit. Still the old Peter. Surely not, Lord. It's a real echo of the old Peter, but he did what he was told, didn't he? God doesn't change our personalities entirely. Otherwise, we'd all be the same, and that would be a bit boring. I could do with changing a bit, as perhaps you feel you could do with changing a bit, but we're all a bit different from each other, and it's good that it's that way. God doesn't change us entirely so that our personalities are unrecognizable. But he does want to be in us wholly and guide us and lead us and show us new things by his Spirit. It's true, though, that from time to time, we need a refill of the Spirit. And that's what I want you to consider at the end of this morning. To invite the Spirit to fill you up again, refill you, maybe fill the corners that haven't been filled before. Give him again complete charge. Give him charge over your life so that he'll speak to you. lead you and guide you into other people's lives, into situations that you wouldn't have dreamed of, and bless you at the same time. I bet Peter left there to go back to Joppa after those few days, having had his socks... No, they didn't wear socks, did they? Having had his sandals blessed off. Because that's what happens when we're blessing other people. If you've never asked God by his Holy Spirit to fill you, then here's a chance to do it. I'm not going to ask people to come and stand out at the front or stand in their places or do anything like that. But I'm going to play a song, and I'd like you, while it's playing, it's one you know, you could sing it if you wanted to, you could sit and think, you could sit and pray, use the song in your own way. It says, Holy Spirit, we welcome you. And if you do welcome the Spirit, tell him so. Tell him so. And invite him to fill you again. To fill you for the first time. To top you up. Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you that you gave us your Spirit, your presence with us when you went back to the Father. We thank you that he is ready to dwell in us, to live and move and act in us, which is a miracle. A miracle. Lord, we ask you that he may have his own way unreservedly in our lives. That as we come to this time of the year, with opportunities for speaking to people, influencing people, loving people, the Spirit may be in charge. That unreservedly, he may have his way. For blessing of many outsiders, blessing of your church. Lord, help us to be as prepared and willing for new things as Cornelius and Peter were. That nothing in us as church, nothing in us as individuals will hinder what you want to do. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our postcode is UB69UA. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034 and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.